In today's lecture, we are going to study about colon-targeted drug delivery systems. And the reason that we need to study such systems is that many of the inflammatory bowel diseases, including irritable bowel syndrome, ulcerative colitis, and Crohn's disease, are considered to be serious colonic disorders. A large number of these diseases lead to deaths in India, and the incidence of deaths is much higher in the Western countries. Also, most of the conventional delivery systems which are used for treating the colon disorders are failing because the drug does not reach the site of action in appropriate concentrations. This means that although administered, let us say, by any of the conventional routes such as oral drug delivery or parenteral drug delivery, the drug is not able to achieve therapeutically effective concentrations at the target site. Hence, it is necessary to develop an effective, safe therapy for such colonic disorders wherein site-specific drug delivery system is developed. And this is a major challenge for pharmaceutical technologists. Remember, the advantages of targeting drugs to specific diseased organs includes delivery of the drug in therapeutically effective concentrations to the target site or as close as possible to the target site, reduction in the dose when given by such targeting, and reduction in the incidence of adverse drug effects. In recent times, colon-specific delivery systems have also gained importance for delivery of proteins and peptide drugs, which are being developed at a very rapid pace in the biotechnology and genetic engineering fields. Such peptides and protein drugs are destroyed and inactivated in the acidic environment of the stomach or by pancreatic enzymes in the small intestine. These drugs are usually administered by the parenteral route. However, this route is inconvenient and expensive. Hence, it is necessary that such an alternative delivery system which can deliver these drugs to the target site is developed. Thus, colonic delivery of numerous drugs such as analgesics, peptides, oral vaccines, insulin, growth hormone, erythropoietin, interferons, and interleukins has been attempted and studied. Also, drug targeting to colon is very useful when an intentional delayed drug absorption is desirable, especially in the treatment of such diseases which have peak symptoms in the early morning, such as asthma, angina, or arthritis. Colonic drug delivery has also been found to be useful for improving the systemic absorption of drugs such as nitrendipine, metoprolol, theophylline, isosorbide mononitrate, etc. However, this technology is still in its infancy and there is requirement of substantial amount of research to be carried out. Generally, colon targeting is achieved by oral or rectal administration of these drugs. Before any formulation development activity is carried out, it is necessary to understand the anatomy and physiology of the target organ as well as the various barriers that the organ presents to the delivery of drugs to this region. Hence, before we proceed with colonic targeted drug delivery, we will first look at the anatomical physiological features of the colon. The GI tract is divided into the stomach, small intestine, and the large intestine. The large intestine extends from the ileocecal junction to the anus and is divided into the colon, the rectum, and the anal canal. The colon itself has different parts, which is the cecum, the ascending colon, the transverse colon, the descending colon, and the sigmoid colon. So these are the parts of the colon. It is about 1.5 meters long in all, and the transverse colon is the longest and the most mobile part. The wall of the colon is composed of four layers. The outermost is the serosa, and which is made up of areolar tissue that is covered with a single layer of squamous mesothelial cells. The major muscular coat of the large intestine is the muscularis externa, which is made up of two layers of muscle fibers. Then you have the submucosa, which is a layer of connective tissue lying immediately beneath the mucosa. And the lining of the colon is the mucosal layer, which is made up of three parts, that is the muscularis mucosa, lamina propria, and the innermost epithelium, which is in contact with the gastrointestinal contents. And the epithelium consists of columnar absorptive cells, goblet cells, and the endocrine cells. It is seen that the gastric emptying of dosage forms is highly variable and depends on whether the subject is fed or fasted. The arrival of the dosage form at the colon is determined by the rate of gastric emptying as well as small intestinal transit time, which is why there is a subject to subject variation. It has been seen that presence of food in the gastrointestinal tract increases gastric residence time of these delivery systems, while the small intestinal transit time is independent of the contents of the food. Hence, dosage forms will take anywhere between 4 to 12 hours to reach the colon once administered orally. And the time required to pass through the colon is as high as 20 to 30 hours. So a total time of 3 to 4 hours is taken, 4 to 12 hours is required for the contents of the stomach, that is the colon delivery systems, to reach the colon once administered orally. But once it reaches the colon, it remains in the colon for as long as 20 to 30 hours and is also influenced by diet, dietary fiber content, mobility, stress, disease state, and presence of other drugs. Disease states such as diarrhea and constipation substantially influence the residence time of the drug. As the residence time of the delivery system in the colon is as high as 20 to 30 hours, it is very necessary for us to understand the colonic microflora, which is going to greatly influence the fate of the drug that reaches the colon. It is seen that a large number of aerobic and anaerobic bacteria are present throughout the entire length of the GI tract, out of which more than 400 strains of anaerobic bacteria itself are present in the colon in concentrations as high as 10 raised to 12 CFU per ml. The most important anaerobes that are found in the colon include the bacteroids Bifidobacterium, Eubacterium, Peptococcus, Peptostreptococcus, Ruminococcus, Propionibacterium, and Clostridium. Several other commonly found bacteria include E. coli and Lactobacillus. It is seen that approximately 30% of the weight of feces consists of bacteria. Because of the presence of these anaerobic organisms as well as these commonly found bacteria E. coli and Lactobacillus, some important metabolic processes are carried out by these microflora on the drugs that reach the colon. And these include hydrolysis, reduction, dehydroxylation, dealkylation, dehalogenation, desamination, heterocyclic ring fission, acetylation, and esterification. So in general, this is the composition of microflora in the colon, and these are the effects they have on the drugs that manage to reach the colon after their transit through the GI tract, that is the stomach, and the small intestine. Once the drugs reach the colon, they remain there for a period of 20 to 30 hours. They are acted upon by these bacteria, anaerobic bacteria, which are present in very high concentration. And these bacteria act upon, metabolize, degrade the drug. And these microorganisms are also excreted along with the feces. Factors such as age, GI disease, drug intake, and dietary content can enhance the activity of the drugs or reduce the activity of the drug. Some of the common infections that are seen in the colon and which need treatment by targeting to the colon include the irritable bowel syndrome, ulcerative colitis, Crohn's disease, certain infectious diseases caused by microflora, and colon cancer. It is seen that most of the conventional drug delivery systems fail because the drugs cannot reach the site of action in therapeutically effective concentrations. Hence, there is a pressing need for site-specific drug delivery systems for treatment of colonic disorders. It has been found that colon is an ideal site for delivery to and absorption of peptides and protein drugs because of longer residence time, remember 20 to 30 hours. Lesser peptidases are not present in the colon. Natural absorptive characteristics of the colon due to its larger surface area and high response to the use of absorption enhancers in the formulation. Such delivery systems are also useful for intentional delayed drug absorption in case of conditions which flare up early in the morning, such as asthma, angina, or arthritis. Common routes which are used, like I already explained to you, are that these such drugs can be given either orally or it can be given rectally. The drawback of rectal drug delivery is that the rectum lacks well-defined villi and the contents that are present in the rectum have high viscosity which will impede the absorption of drugs that are given by this route. Also, non-specific binding of the drug with bacterial byproducts which are excreted may be seen. Similarly, the rectum consists of an unstirred water layer which forms a barrier to the absorption of drugs. The pH gradient of the rectum may not be favorable to the absorption of these drugs. And finally, enzymatic degradation of drugs that are administered by the rectal route may be seen. Thus, the common routes of administration of colonic drug delivery systems is either by the oral route or by the rectal route. If given by the oral route, then many physiological barriers have to be overcome and the drug before the drug gets absorbed. Also, the drug should not be degraded in the upper regions of the GI tract. The advantages of the rectal delivery system I have already discussed. Continuing with the drawbacks of colonic targeting. Colonic mucosa lacks well-defined villi, unlike in case of small intestine, and hence absorptive surface area is less. So there are chances that although the drug is retained for 20 to 30 hours in the colon, it may still not be absorbed to an appreciable extent. The viscosity of colonic contents is high, hence the diffusion of drug from the lumen to the mucosal epithelia is slow. Specific, non-specific binding with dietary components and products released from the colonic bacteria can lead to reduction in the extent of absorption or enzymatic degradation may take place. The mucosal layer lining the rectum may bind to the drugs and it may either attract the drugs which are positively charged or it may repel the negatively charged drugs. So a lot of variability in absorption pattern is seen. The unstirred aqueous layer between the mucus and the epithelial cells can act as a barrier for the lipophilic drugs if they are administered by this route. pH gradient, which exists across the aqueous layer, may alter the solubility of the drugs and penetration into the epithelial layer. Also, presence of enzymes in the aqueous layer can influence drug absorption. Drugs which finally manage to enter the epithelium after overcoming all these barriers may undergo extensive enzymatic degradation, or the drug may degrade in the submucosal layer. Drugs that enter the venous capillaries after penetrating through the mucus and the epithelium are transported to liver and they go through the hepatic portal system and may undergo metabolism. Thus, there are various drawbacks and barriers to colonic targeting, and one needs to understand all these barriers and drawbacks before designing the appropriate delivery system for targeting drugs to the colon. To address the problems and deliver the drugs to the colon, let us look at these approaches. The first approach that we are going to look into is called as the prodrug approach. The word prodrug refers to a pharmacologically inactive compound that is transformed into an active substance when it reaches the target site and gets metabolized. Prodrug approach helps to overcome some common problems such as chemical instability, inadequate penetration into the brain, poor aqueous solubility, local irritation, toxicity, and insufficient therapeutic concentrations at the target site. In the case of colon-specific drug delivery, prodrug approach has been tried with a small amount of success. And here, let us look at one of the examples of prodrug approach used for targeting drugs to the colon. The prodrug sulfasalazine has been used in the treatment of ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease. Chemically, sulfasalazine is 5-aminosalicylic acid combined with sulfapyridine by azo bonds. On reaching the colon, the azo bond is reduced by the azo reductase to 5-ASA and sulfapyridine. And it is this sulfapyridine that is responsible for side effects of sulfasalazine. Therefore, such a system has its drawbacks because of the presence of sulfapyridine. In order to solve this problem, the drug olsalazine that consists of 2-ASA molecules linked by an azo bond was developed for the purpose of delivering 5-ASA to the colon and avoiding sulfapyridine and thereby absence of side effects. Thus, in one of the prodrug approaches, sulfasalazine was used for treatment of ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease. However, side effects induced due to sulfapyridine were observed. To overcome this, the drug was chemically modified into olsalazine, which consisted of 5-ASA molecules that were linked by an azo bond. In another approach, the 5-ASA was coupled to a spacer group by an azo bond, and this complex was then linked to a larger polymer that can bind non-covalently to mucine that is present in the colon. Glycosidases are a prominent group of enzymes that are present in the intestinal microflora. The major glycosidases that are found in human feces includes the beta-D-galactosidase, alpha-L-arabinofuranosidase, and beta-D-xylopyranosidase. The prodrugs of certain steroids such as prednisolone, dexamethasone, hydrocortisone, and fludrocortisone were prepared, and these are hydrophilic. These are not absorbed in the small intestine and they proceed to the large intestine, namely the colon. On reaching the colon, such prodrugs of prednisolone or the other steroids are broken down by colonic glycosidases, releasing the corticosteroids at the site of action. Thus the prodrugs of these steroids were found to be more effective in delivering the corticosteroids to the site of action, that is the colon. Another class of macromolecules called as the dextran ester prodrugs has been found to be very useful in colon-specific drug delivery. These prodrugs, which consist of the dextran ester moieties, when reach the colon, are acted upon by the colonic dextranases and release the active moiety. One example that is very popular is that of the dextran ester prodrug of naproxen, which was synthesized and tested in the laboratory. It was seen that when the prodrug reached the colon, it was acted upon by the colonic dextranases, and the release of naproxen from the dextran ester prodrug was 15 to 17 times faster as seen in laboratory studies or in vitro studies, and the extent of bioavailability was as high as 100%. This prodrug required the presence of a carboxyl functional group in the drug. Hence, it is not suitable for all drug molecules. Only those drug moieties which are having a carboxyl functional group in the drugs can be converted to dextran ester prodrug, and this ensures its delivery to the colon in an intact form and release of drug upon action by the colonic dextranases. In case carboxyl function is not present in the group, then carboxyl function can be deliberately introduced into the drug moiety, and then it may be converted into a prodrug by reaction with dextran ester. This approach was used for dexamethasone and methylprednisolone, which do not possess carboxylic functional groups. Therefore, these were then attached to dextran using succinic acid as a spacer. The succinic acid is now the source of carboxylic group, and the prodrug consists of dexamethasone, succinic acid, and dextran ester. When this is delivered to the colon, it is acted upon by the colonic dextranases, releasing the active moiety, and thus the active moiety reaches the target site in high concentrations. These examples demonstrate the usefulness of the prodrug approach and the significance of conjugates for selective delivery of glucocorticoids to the large intestine. The next approach that we are going to look at is the approach used for enteric coated dosage forms, wherein the tablet or capsule is coated with a pH-sensitive polymer. The same technique can be used here to develop colon-specific targeted drug delivery systems. Here, the drugs are formulated into solid dosage forms, the conventional ones such as the tablets or the capsules or into pellets, and these are then coated with pH-sensitive polymers. The most commonly used polymers in such cases are Eudragit L and S. Eudragit L and S are copolymers of methacrylic acid and methyl methacrylate. Eudragit L is soluble at a pH of 6 and above and can be used for enteric coating. As against this, Eudragit S is soluble at a pH of 7 and above and can be used to deliver drugs to the small bowel, end of the small bowel, and the large intestine. 5-ASA, the example we looked at in the previous slide, is commercially available as an oral dosage form and is coated with Eudragit L100 or Eudragit S. Thus, the use of Eudragit L and S provides a great degree of assurance that the delivery system can be targeted to the colon. However, this technique has several disadvantages, and one of the foremost disadvantage is lack of consistency in the dissolution of the polymer at the desired site. Also, variability in dissolution characteristics of the polymer due to the influence of motility of the GI tract, presence of dietary components in the GI fluids is seen. There is a lack of site specificity. Wherever the polymer encounters a pH of 6 and above, it dissolves and releases the drug. Similarly, large amount of variation is due to the presence of short chain fatty acids, residues of bile acids, carbon dioxide, and other fermentation products, which when generated in the colon, reduce the pH of the colon to below 7 and as low as 6. Therefore, a large amount of variation is seen when such dosage forms are formulated, wherein you have conventional tablets, capsules, or pellets coated with polymers such as Utrigit LNS. Site specificity is poor, variability in the dissolution characteristics due to pH, due to motility of the GI tract, presence of dietary components, enzymes, fatty acids, bile acids, fermentation products, which are normally found in the colon. Therefore, this is an approach that is subject to great amount of variability. So, what are the other approaches that can be used if we do not want to use these earlier two approaches? Advantage can be taken of certain natural polysaccharides such as pectin and xylan, which by degree of its complex nature are not digested in the human stomach or intestine but are degraded in the colon by the bacteria that reside in the colon. Several such bacterial enzymes released by the bacteria residing in the colon are capable of degrading a wide variety of polysaccharides that are present in the diet. The result is that the polysaccharides are fermented and the gases that are released include methane, carbon dioxide, hydrogen, and several short chain fatty acids are also released. One of the polysaccharides that is under investigation for its role as a carrier for drugs targeting the colon delivery system is pectin. Pectin is an anionic polysaccharide that is extracted from the plant and it has a high methoxy content. Such high methoxy content pectin, when applied as a compression coat around a tablet, helps in avoiding disintegration in the stomach and small intestine and preferentially leads to dissolution of the drug in the colon. And this happens because the formulation which does not disintegrate in the upper GI tract reaches the colon and is acted by several of the bacterial enzymes ending up in releasing the drug at the target site. Thus, successful delivery of the drug to the colon is achieved when it is coated by dry coating of pectin which has high methoxy content. The end result is the drug is released. Also, gases such as methane, carbon dioxide, or hydrogen may be released. Thus, if pectin were to be used as a coating material for colon target delivery system, selection of the pectin, which is from a natural source, should be such that it should either have a high methoxy content or it should have low methoxy content but with controlled calcium levels. Chondroitin sulfate is a soluble mucopolysaccharide that is used as a substrate by the bacterioids which inhabit the large intestine. It consists of D-glucuronic acid linked to N-acetyl-D-galactosamide. The natural source of chondroitin sulfate is the epithelial cells and dietary meat. This chondroitin sulfate-based drug delivery systems can be used for targeting drugs to the colon. Another example that has been studied is that of inulin, a naturally occurring carbohydrate which occurs in plants such as onion and garlic. It consists of oligomers and polymers containing 2 to 60 or more D-fructose molecules which are linked. Inulin can resist hydrolysis and digestion in the upper GI tract. However, when it reaches the colon, it is fermented by the colonic microflora, specifically by the bifidobacteria and bacterioids, thus releasing the drug. Thus, inulin hydrogel carriers for colonic drug delivery have been studied and reported by a group of scientists. Next, we come to chitosan. Delivery system based on amylose for colon-specific drug delivery has been reported, in which chitosan, a high molecular weight cationic polysaccharide, has been studied. Now, we know that chitosan is a pharmaceutical excipient which is used to improve the dissolution of poorly soluble drugs or for sustained release of drugs. This is a high molecular weight polysaccharide, and it was used to deliver insulin to the colon and was studied in rats. It was found to enable delivery of insulin to the colon. Thus, these are all experimental laboratory based studies, the inulin and chitosan, wherein they have shown promise in delivering drugs to the colon. A group of scientists led by Lehmann formulated a suspension of natural polygalactomannans in polymethacrylate solutions to form degradable coatings, and this suspension was used to form a layer around a drug core, and this led to a protective coat which delayed the release of the drug till it reached the colon. Upon reaching the colon, the coat was destroyed enzymatically in the colon and the drug was released. Thus, polymethacrylates can be used as such also can be used to improve the film forming properties and the protective properties. Thus the polysaccharides in polymethacrylate solutions have been found to be successful in giving protective effect on the drug till it reaches the colon, where the protective layer is acted upon by the bacteria that is present in the colon and degraded enzymatically, leading to release of the drug. Guar gum is a naturally occurring polysaccharide that is derived from the seeds of the leguminosae family. It has been used as a carrier in indomethacin tablets, and it was found that use of guar gum in the formulation of tablets can help to prevent the release of the drug in the stomach and the small intestine. When the formulation reaches the colon, bacterial enzymes act upon and break down the guar gum and thereby release the drug. In order to reach a definite conclusion, a group of rats was pre-treated orally with guar gum dispersion, and this was found to induce enzyme production in the colon. Therefore, this led to a greater extent of drug release because the enzymes that were produced in the colon acted immediately upon the formulation once it reached the colon. Thus, in order to make a colon-targeted drug delivery system, the tablet was compression coated with guar gum, and such a system was studied on various drugs, and it was found that this system was effective in targeting the release of several drugs to the colon. In the previous slides, we have looked at some conventional drug delivery systems that were modified either by coating or by dry compression and by the use of several high molecular weight polysaccharides or naturally occurring celluloses and gums as protectives in the acidic environment and the environment of the small intestine. But when these systems reached the colon, they were acted upon by the bacterial microflora or because of the pH and released the drug at the desired site of action. Now, we will look at an example of a novel drug delivery system for delivery of drugs to the colon. And the example that we are going to study is that of OROS CT, O-R-O-S. CT developed by Alza Corporation. The OROS CT is used to target drugs to the colon for treatment of disease or to achieve systemic absorption via the colon. OROS CT system may be a single osmotic unit or may have multiple units, 5 to 6 units in one capsule, hard gelatin capsule. So each of these systems is nothing but a bilayered push-pull unit, which consists of an osmotic push layer containing an osmotic agent and a drug layer containing the drug in solution or dispersion, and both of which are surrounded by a semi-permeable membrane. And orifice is drilled through the membrane and has access to the drug layer. Once the OROS CT system is swallowed, and this OROS CT system is enteric coated, okay? So once it is swallowed, the gelatin capsule disintegrates, leaving all these units free. Now these units are coated with a drug impermeable enteric coating, and therefore no water enters into the system in the acidic environment of the stomach. As the unit enters the small intestine, this enteric coating slowly starts dissolving in the higher pH environment. Water starts entering into the unit, causes the osmotic unit compartment, that is the slower compartment, to swell. You know what happens in case of an osmotic unit. As the compartment swells, the diaphragm that is separating the osmotic compartment from the drug compartment pushes against the drug layer. The osmotic compartment also swells. Subsequently, the drug solution or dispersion is forced out of the orifice at a controlled rate. Thus, when you have 5 or 6 push-pull units in one system, then each unit is designed to release the drug with a 3 to 4 hour post-gastric delay. Thus, drug release begins when the unit reaches the colon, and these units can maintain a constant release rate for as long as 24 hours in the colon. This results, the end result is steady state release of the drug in the colon for a time period of as long as 24 hours. Another novel drug delivery system that is used for colon targeting is the pulsing cap system that has been developed by R.R. Schering Corporation of the USA. In this system, as you can see, there is a capsule whose body is water insoluble, and it contains a reservoir of the drug, which is either the drug in a solution form or in a dispersion form. The drug's dispersion is sealed inside this capsule body with the means of a swellable hydrogel plug, and the cap of the capsule is made up of soluble polymer, and it is coated with a acid insoluble layer. When such a system is introduced into the GI tract, it first encounters the acidic environment of the stomach. However, because the entire body of the cap as well as the cap of the capsule is water insoluble and acid, not affected by the acid, this system is not affected. Once it goes into the small intestine, the enteric coating dissolves, the cap of the capsule dissolves, and now the body of the capsule, which contains the drug dispersion and is closed by a hydrogel plug, encounters the aqueous environment of the small intestine. The hydrogel plug absorbs water and it starts swelling. As this system passes further down into the colon, now the hydrogel plug has swollen to such an extent that it is ejected out of the polymeric capsule body, of the capsule body, and the drug dispersion or solution is now released into the colon from where it is absorbed. So this is an example of a modern novel drug delivery system called the pulsing cap system, which is responsible for targeting the drug to the colon. The principle here is the insolubility of the enclosed capsule in the acidic environment, dissolution of the cap in the alkaline environment of the small intestine, and swelling of the hydrogel plug, and finally release of the hydrogel, ejection of the hydrogel plug, and release of the contents at the colon. So with this, we have looked at various systems for targeting drugs to the colon. Several more examples of systems can be found in literature, and you can go through the same and look up examples of different systems, both conventional as well as novel drug delivery, that can be used for delivering the drug to the colon. The pulsing cap type of system is also categorized as a timed release dosage system. This is a dosage system in which the formulation arrives at the ileocecal junction about 3 to 4 hours after dosing. As discussed in the previous slide, where a schematic representation was drawn, the pulsing cap system consists of two halves of the capsule, the body and the cap. The body is non-disintegrating and the cap is enteric coated. When the system passes through the stomach, because of the acidic environment, there is no change. But when it enters into the small intestine, the enteric coat dissolves and exposes the hydrogel plug. This plug absorbs water from the small intestine and it swells. And when the system reaches the colon, the plug is ejected. This exposes the drug dispersion to the external environment, and thus the drug is released, dissolved, and absorbed. The disadvantage of the pulsing cap system is that it has very poor site specificity due to large variations in the gastric emptying time, as well as the variations in the time required when it passes across the ileocecal junction. So with this, we have completed an overview of the different types of systems, drug delivery systems, which can be used to target drugs to the colon. Finally, now let us evaluate these systems. A colon-specific drug delivery system is successful only if it remains intact in the physiological environment of the stomach and the small intestine, but will release the drug in the colon. To evaluate this, several in vitro and in vivo methods have been described. So let us look at these systems in brief. First, going on to the in vitro systems. In vitro systems will evaluate the extent of drug released in the environment of the stomach, the small intestine, as well as the colon. For this purpose, drug release dissolution studies are carried out on the system for 2 hours in gastric pH, that is 0.1 normal HCl. These are in vitro studies carried out using the dissolution apparatus, wherein the system is studied using IP type 1 apparatus or IP type 2 apparatus. Dissolution medium is 0.1 normal HCl. The system is stirred for 2 hours and the extent of drug released is measured by a suitable method. Then the 0.1 normal HCl is removed from the dissolution flask and replaced with Sorensen's phosphate buffer pH 7.4 for a period of 3 hours, and the extent of drug that is released in the system is evaluated by suitable analytical technique. Limits that are laid down are referred to understand the profile of the drug and to predict whether the most of the drug will be released in the colon. In the next method, delivery system is incubated in buffer medium in the presence of enzymes, such as dextrinases, as well as cecal contents of the rat or the guinea pig or the rabbit. This is done in order to replicate the in vivo conditions in vitro atmosphere. Finally, gradient dissolution studies can also be carried out on these delivery systems to understand the release pattern throughout the GI tract. So this is the set of in vitro methods that can be used for evaluation of the colon specific drug delivery systems. Additionally, in vivo studies may be carried out wherein different animal models are used for evaluating the performance of these delivery systems. The examples of animals that can be used for the in vivo studies include guinea pigs and rats. Various techniques that can be used in these in vivo methods are the in string technique, endoscopy, radio telemetry, roentgenography, and gamma scintigraphy, which can be used for monitoring the in vivo behavior of these oral dosage forms. In order to know more about the details of the techniques that can be used for in vivo evaluation of these colon-based drug delivery systems, you can refer to standard textbooks and references that are given in the syllabus. It has been seen that a considerable amount of research has been carried out in developing such colon-specific drug delivery systems. Large inter and intra-subject variation in the gastrointestinal pH makes the approach of delivery systems based on pH-dependent polymers less suitable. Therefore, the preferred systems are those which rely on conditions encountered in the colon. So, systems which can be degraded by colonic bacteria are the most promising techniques that can be used for colonic drug delivery. Natural polymers such as dextran, pectin, guar gum are more preferred because they are safe. They are known and they are safe. With this, the topic of colon-specific drug delivery system has been completed. Thank you.